in Christ. Good evening.
Good evening.
Maybe I should put it a little further this way. Good evening.
Good evening.
Much better. My name is Pastor Sam, and welcome to the Greene Charge Revival. This is 2019. This is my second revival, and I am blessed abundant to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Even though we're mostly Mount Vernon folks tonight, in case you didn't know, our bathroom is right through this door, and it's to the right. Now, my friends, let us come together, and let us have a quick prayer to begin this evening, if you'll bow your heads with me today. Righteous Sovereign and Almighty King, we are overjoyed to be back in your house. Father, we just ask for your Holy Spirit to pour upon us today. Allow us to acknowledge your presence here. Allow us to be filled with your Holy Spirit, and allow us to sing joyfully. Allow us to respond to the words about being unified in action. Let us share your words with the whole world, Father. Let us be your children. Let us be your servants. Amen.
Amen.
So as y'all might know, I'm a pretty simplistic guy. I like to keep things simple. So when it comes to me for revival, I think we should all start with singing a song together. And then we'll go and we'll listen to some music. We'll have a time of prayers and a time of offering. Then we'll have the message about unity in action. We'll listen to some more music, and then we'll have a closing hymn. Does that sound good to y'all?
Yep.
If not, feel free just to say, Preacher Sam, we don't like that. We are all unified in Christ here. You're not going to hurt my feelings. We're all brothers and sisters. Now, if y'all would look in your Cokesbury hymnal, number 123 is Revive Us Again. And I'd ask that you do whatever you're led to do. If you feel better sitting down while you're singing, if you're like me and need to stand up to sing, please join me. But if not, do as you will. Let us sing Revive Us Again. Another year. They haven't kicked me out yet. I thought, oh, you meant here.
Yeah.
Like in church.
Yeah.
Okay. I thought you meant like all of us are still here. Like Pastor Sam, they haven't kicked you out yet. So speaking of the churches, I know that we're blessed abundant. We've actually seen growth at both of our churches. And we've been able to get out and be doing more events in our community, which has been fantastic. We've had another Christmas together, we've just had another Easter together, and we have had a lot of good times together.
Amen.
Nothing, y'all?
Amen.
What do you got? Come on, stand up. Oh, okay. Do whatever you feel like you're led to do. Praise be to God for graduations. Praise be to God for peace and completion. What else y'all got? All right. We'll come back to that. Oh, I got hands. Lillian, you're
Joy, Dana and Mark made it to London. They landed about 4 o'clock this afternoon.
Amen. Praise be to God for safe travels. Jan.
Well, I'm happy that I'm here for another revival.
Amen.
After all these years, and I remember some real good ones. So let's just pray that that this is just going to be the beginning.
Amen.
And we'll just speed up over the week. And let, I hope that I did pass around the first time, I don't know why I never did it before, some of our invitations. This, and it felt so good to put them in people's mailboxes. So even if we only get one.
Amen.
That's a blessing.
All I must say is that I have faith this is going to be a wonderful revival. I know that we've got speakers from all different denominations, from all different churches of all different sizes. I know that this will be a holy gathering site for the next 7 days. So much, in fact, that we're actually going from 3 days to 6. So something good's happening. And as I've been told in Scripture, all we need is the faith of a mustard seed. And for y'all that don't know I do this all the time, but you see my pen? You see the tip of my pen? You see the ballpoint of the pen? That's the size of a mustard seed. It's all you need. A small amount of faith, and the Lord will take care of the rest. Are there any other moments of joy? Joanne.
I was working at Montpelier today. I give tours in the mansion. And on my tour, it always comes out about Madison and freedom of religion. We have him to thank for that.
Amen. We are blessed to live in a place where we can gather together, where we can gather together freely and safely to worship our God and to share in the message that we hear.
And Sam, I have so many joys I'd be here all night talking about it, but I think, well, as I was going through in my head, I think the one that probably sticks out the most for Mount Vernon for me is Ronald Morris.
Amen.
His journey in this church has been amazing all by itself. I've never heard him not want to stand up and talk about Jesus. And then to go through what he's gone through and to sit over there like he sits with peace. He looked awesome today. And he's just, through his journey, instead of getting bitter or pitiful or what goes with that, and I'm sure it does, he seems so much more even closer to Christ. He's just a good witness for me. I draw off of him a lot. I just think he's an amazing man. So
amen.
For Mount Vernon to have that in their church and to have that kind of testimony. And you too. I talk about you quite a bit, to be such a young man in the pulpit and to be such a disciple of Christ, because you really do explain the word to us in a way that is maybe different, but powerful, and different is okay, powerful is better. So it's just, we really do appreciate you. And I know that as a whole for the church, because we've talked about you behind your back. And maybe in front of your face, I don't know. But I just think with the whole year gone by, I think you're gonna, unless you choose to go somewhere, I think you'll be here really well.
Praise be to God for not just my opportunity to be with y'all as my family, because I'm so thankful y'all have just embraced me like I've been here my whole life in Greene. It makes my heart feel so great to know that I have a family like y'all, but also, like you said, all of the pillars of faith we have not just here, but at South River. Mm-hmm. All of the lifelong church members that can offer their wisdom and experience and guidance for all peoples of the church. We're blessed abundant with all the gifts and talents that our churches have that we can share with the world. And I think that's a good segue for skills and talents, if you're ready, Judy.
Pardon me?
Are you ready to play some music?
Yeah, I'll play a couple songs.
My friends, it is my absolute pleasure to invite Judy packed her up to play some music for us. She is an Auto Harp Hall of Fame member, and she goes to our church at South River. So please, a round of applause, my friend.
Life on earth is
sisters. Judy brought up a good point when she mentioned that one reason she came here was because I asked her if she could help us out for our service tonight. And that's what we're talking about here tonight, is unity in action, about being disciples of Jesus Christ and working together for the glory of God, not for the glory of Mount Vernon, not for the glory of South River, not for the glory of the United Methodists, but for the glory of Jesus Christ alone. And I think I found something in these wonderful old books that I'd like to share with y'all, if you would join me. It's all the way in the back. It's 332. And, you know, I'm not going to lie to y'all that the readings that are in here put the hymnals readings to shame. These are fantastic. I was just sitting here and I happened to be flipping through it and it ended up right here. And if any of y'all are there already at 332, this is what we're talking about tonight. Brotherhood in God. So if y'all were there with me, would you give me an amen?
Amen.
Got plenty, all right. So I'm going to read the italicized text, if y'all will read the bold text with me tonight. Of a truth I perceive that God is no respecter of persons, but in every nation he hath feareth him, and worketh righteousness is accepted by him. He hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell for all on the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before the appointed and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, even though he is not far from every one of us. If ye fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, thou shalt love your neighbor as thyself, ye do well. You commit sin. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all the rich unto that call upon him.
The rich and poor meet together. The Lord is the maker of them all.
Amen. Amen. Maybe it's just the King James vibe that that hymnal gives me, but it's a reminder to all of us that it doesn't matter where we came from. It doesn't matter where we're at now today. What matters is where our allegiances lie in this world. Are we children of the world, or are we children of the living God, of the Messiah who has called us here to continue showing his good works? Not just in worship, not just in song or in prayer, but also in action, also in speaking God's word, also in receiving his word and sharing his message with all peoples. Not just the people we see here in church where we shake your hands every Sunday and we're like, oh, it's so good to see you. I haven't seen you all week. All peoples. Every single person that we meet, whether they are at their job, whether we are just passing them by at the store, wherever they are, we are called to call every single one of them brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ. We invite them into our family with open hearts, open minds, and open doors. Man, I can't believe I got all that just out of that little scripture read. But, Edie, what did you want to say? You don't know. Do you want to sing now or after I'm done preaching?
I don't care.
Anyone got a coin? We'll flip a coin at that rate. Doesn't bother me none. Would you like to sing now or later? How about that?
I don't care.
Edie, come on.
Sing now, Edie.
Oh, sing now.
Come on, sing now, Edie.
All right. The congregation has decided.
We can't wait.
Please welcome up Edie, a member of Mount Vernon Church. I think you can do it without the mic. You're pretty loud.
I might mess up.
We don't know that. You've never messed up for us. What are you singing?
Something in the water.
Something in the water.
Yeah.
Is that what it's called? I thought you forgot the first word. I was like, something in the water.
It's too.
Something in the water.
Thank you.
Edie, that was wonderful.
Awesome.
And I'm so happy you didn't use the microphone.
Me too.
I had to open our sound system.
Good job.
So my friends, we got two big things to take care of as disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I would not be doing my job as our preacher if I did not ask tonight, are there any prayers that we need to lift up that we didn't get a chance to at church this morning? Is there anything on our hearts we need to lift up tonight? Amen. Blaze, we're so thankful.
Yep.
We're so thankful to have you, and we're glad you're out of the hospital.
Yep.
So we're going to pray for continued recovery for you. Is there anything else to lift up tonight? All right. Well, if there's nothing else, let's go to the Lord in prayer, y'all, for another prayer, just to lift up healing and mercy and wisdom. Please join me in prayer. Mighty Savior and merciful King, we are just so gracious to be in your house tonight. We're thankful for your servant Blaze, who is able to join us here tonight. After being injured, after being in the hospital, Lord, you have shown him your mercy and have allowed him to come join us tonight. And we are forever grateful for all of the spirits here tonight to join us in your heavenly praise, God, because we do not do this for ourselves. We do this for the Lord God on high. We do this for you, so that we may serve you as you have commanded us to love our neighbors as ourselves and to love you above all else. Let us continue being your disciples. Let us be full of your spirit and let this continue to flourish, to be the beginning of a snowball just going down the hill. Lord, let us continue to see more souls join us. Let us continue to hear more praise and thanksgivings and testimonies. Let us continue to see your spirit wild through Greene. Allow us to continue to see your will, your mercy, and your love for all of your children. And let all of God's children say, Amen.
Amen.
The second thing is, I've got a little story to tell you. And we'll get into the second thing in a minute. So one of the reasons that we are doing this revival is with the Greene County Ministerial Association, that we have had the absolute pleasure to help our local youth going through graduations to the high schools, that we offer a scholarship called the Martin Luther King Jr. Scholarship, where we're able to give each student who applies and is accepted $1,000 for their scholarship to be able to help with education, to help with equipment, and to help for college and beyond. So as all five or all six of us speak, we will be having some time of offering and thanksgiving. And I'd like to start that with a story, reminding us of what it really means to pay forward into our society and into our youth and children. You see, yesterday I was part of a wonderful event at the Public Broadcasting System, or PBS. They had an event in town over in the valley. And me and my wife and my daughter went, and we had a good old time. We did see Clifford the dog this time, but we had a lot of activities and events. And we got a phone call while we were having lunch. And it was an old church member I haven't at least seen in probably 2-3 years. And she says, hey, I really need some help. Do you happen to be in the valley? We're like, yeah, we happen to be in the valley. And she says, my car ran out of gas. Can you go and get a gas can and fill it up with gas? And can you guys come save me? And I was like, oh man, this is totally going to ruin our schedule. We have something perfectly planned. It's going to be great. So of course my spirit says, okay, yeah, we'll help you out right away. So we go and we go buy an oil can. Oil cans got expensive, by the way, y'all. I don't know if y'all knew that, but they did. So we got an oil can and we got some gas in it. We went to go help her. We put the gas in the car and she gave me a $20 bill. I didn't want her to because I was doing God's work, but I told her, I said, if you're gonna give me this, it's gonna go back on the offering plate. So I would like to start our offering tonight with $20 that the Lord has given back to me, because I don't want it, it's not mine. So I'm gonna begin this offering with my own contribution to the Ministerial Association, aside from the other donations that we do. And we don't have a whole lot of people tonight, so Judy, would you mind playing something short for us?
Sure.
And I'm just going to pass the plate along myself, because something I learned growing up is you should never ask someone to do something you're not willing to do yourself. And Jesus the Christ himself was the leader of servants, the King of Kings. So let me serve you. Savior and merciful King, we ask that you accept this offering in your mighty hand and bless it abundantly, not for our own works, not for our own pride, but for our youth in our county, Lord. Let it lift up the children of our county. Let it have them continue to have an education, to continue to flourish, to continue to show your goodwill all around, Lord, as we have met 8 wonderful applicants this year. And we were blessed abundant that all 8 could be accepted. Allow us to continue doing your will and your will alone as we declare in your heavenly precious name. Amen.
Amen.
So now, my brothers and sisters in Christ, the real reason y'all showed up, right? It's not because of the music. No, I'm just kidding. You guys totally should have came just for the music. It's time to get some preaching, isn't it? We're getting a little later into the day, and as you all know, I've had a pretty long day. So I think I'm not going to waste any time, because we have a lot of ground to cover tonight, as I am the opening service for Unity in Action, and what exactly that means. So we're going to work together on this with one another in God's mighty kingdom. We're going to go through a crash course, wrong book, of this entire book tonight. We're going to go through the Bible step by step, and we're going to talk about what unity in action really means, from the cover to the cover. We're going to talk about what it means to be united in Jesus the Christ, and I think that's the best place to do it, is to start where unity began and to end where unity is complete. So I'm going to go ahead and start with Genesis, and we're going to bounce around a little bit, but we're going to go ahead and start at the very beginning. The very first day that God created, he created the light and the darkness and separated them. He said this was good, and he ended the first day. Now, that first section, we're not talking about the sun. We're not talking about a day and a night cycle with the light and the darkness, because that would come in another day. We're talking about the balance that God has created from the very beginning, the balance of righteous and unrighteous, the balance of what God's kingdom would be, because in all things, there needs to be a balance. Later on, God created his creatures. He created the animals of the sea and the sky and the land. But then something interesting happens, and I believe it's around chapter 2. The Spirit of the Lord comes down, and he says, let us create in our image a new creation. Let us create in our image, the first symbol of unity in our scripture, reminding us of who we are. We are made in God's image. We are made to be united with the sovereign Lord. We are called to, I don't even know if I need this.
I hate all the buzzing, so I'm going to go without it. If my microphone doesn't work, my microphone doesn't work. We are united with the Creator God immediately, as it says, He blew out of the nostrils of his nose the spirit into man. That word is called ruach. I've said this several times, but ruach is the spiritual force that we all are made from, that we are all united and created from, the image of our Lord. And that doesn't always mean that God has two arms, two legs, two eyes and a nose and ears, but we're talking about his image in the way of his rationality, his logic, his mercy, his creation of culture, of buildings, of making things with our hands, because we cannot create things as the Lord God can. He can use us to create things, but we cannot speak things into existence as our Lord God can. We cannot do it alone. We must be united with God Almighty to make this happen. And this is where things start to go downhill. You see, Adam was lonely. So God created another creature from Adam called Eve. And they lived together. And it was wonderful. They were all united in the Garden of Eden. It was great. They could spend time together. They could walk in the garden. They could talk to one another in a fullness, in a wholeness that people think has gone away. My friends, that has not gone away. We're just looking in the wrong places for what we wish to be united with, where we wish to put our allegiances to. We believe that we can make some kind of compromise in our world between being of this world 80% of the time and of God 20% of the time. I think my math is about right on that. 6 out of 7 days we wish to be part of the world, and 1 out of 7 days we like to be part of God. That's not unity. That doesn't work in that kind of balance that we're talking about. But God continued to look after his children, even when they fell short, even when they left the Garden of Eden. They were pushed out. God didn't give up on them. He didn't just brush just the dust off his hand and say, well, that was a bad batch, time to start back over. He continued to work and continued to unify with his children, even when they rebelled, even when they fell short, even when they wouldn't listen. He continued to try to unite with his creations. The next one would obviously be Noah, but I'm going to jump to Abraham, because now we're going to get not just into unity with God, but into unity with other peoples as well. Because once Abraham is on the scene, this old man who God called and said, you will have a new family as numerous as the stars. We start meeting other nations and other tribes along the way. We meet people that are either related to Abraham or people that are complete strangers and not, honestly, some of them are even enemies. For example, Abraham's nephew Lot was taken away by the Sodomites and the Gomorrites. They were taken away into these villages. And there was not a lot of unity there, initially. For you see, Abraham was taken to these towns and says, I need to go get my family out. And God says, these towns are about to be destroyed because of how unjust and how unrighteous these people are. And Abraham says, please, God, if there's 50 righteous people, will you destroy this city? He says, no. So Abraham continues to negotiate with God over and over, trying to unify, trying to find an agreement, find an accord, find the balance to be in God's worthiness. And he says, would you destroy this city for even one righteous person? And God says, no. So they send them out to go find the one righteous person in town. Spoiler alert, they had already left the town. So the towns were unfortunately destroyed. And then we get into when Abraham's wife passes away, Sarah. And this is the first time where we find unity between two different nations. And this is pretty important. Abraham meets up with some group called the Hittites. These are mountain people from the land of Canaan. They go and meet this village and they say, I would love to have a place to bury my wife. And the king of the region comes to him, sells him land. They became unified. As a matter of fact, the Hittites wanted to gift it to Abraham. He said, that's not fair. I need to give you a gift. They were united. Despite being different cultures, they came together to do the work of the Lord. Sometimes that work of the Lord is tragic, like setting up a burial. Sometimes it is tragic, like going to a disaster site where a hurricane or a flood or a tornado has come through. I've gotten to do mission work in my life. I've been in different cultures, and I know for a fact that in every culture all over the world, God's commandments are there. God's testimonies are still there, even in the place where you think there's not a single believer in sight. I promise you there's at least one. I promise you there is at least one person who has heard the name of Jesus Christ who will work with us, work with you, to make God's work happen. As we continue on, I'm going to jump another section, because I want to talk about not just cultures and towns, but I want to expand it further and talk about cultures in empires. So we're trying to build up right now. Now, we've reached a man by the name of Joseph. Most of y'all know him because he had a fancy coat with a whole bunch of colors, and his brothers got really mad at him. So they tried to go and sell him off. Or they thought of a lot of different things. They thought about throwing him in a well. They thought about just killing him. And they said, no, this isn't going to work. So we're going to go and sell him to Egypt. We're going to sell him as a slave. And they do. He goes off to Egypt. He becomes a slave. And he works with Egypt, with a gift that he was given. This gift that Joseph had was prophecy, being able to interpret dreams and being able to understand what they mean. And then we see a child of the living God working with an entirely different culture that didn't believe what he believed, that didn't understand what he understood, but they understood one thing. He has a gift, and he continued to use his gift for the Lord. Even in a different culture, even if, like I said earlier, even if one person believed and you couldn't find them, that doesn't invalidate your gift. That doesn't say that we're not called to use our gifts. We are always called to use our gifts, no matter how grand or no matter how small, no matter how humble we think we're trying to be, or let me use a different word, how bashful we're trying to be with our gifts, where we try to hide them. Kind of like in the story of the talents, where they're trying to hide it in a basket. We say, I can do this, but I don't want to do this. I've been there. In a different culture, in a different land, with different gifts. You see, I don't know if y'all knew this, but before I started in the ministry, I used to work on computers. I've been a computer technician for about a decade now. And when I was on a mission trip in Central America, I didn't want to do what I did for my job. I came here to do something different. So I said, Lord, you're going to make me a builder. You're going to let me go out here, play with power tools, and help build something cool. This is how I know God has a sense of humor, y'all. I got sick. I got heat stroke for 3 days because I did what I wanted to do. And God said, no, you're not. If you're not going to listen to me, you're not going to have any fun. So I had to lay in bed and stare at the ceiling for 3 days. I had already spent, you know, a good bit of money to go on this trip to be able to help. I was sick. But finally, I was like, all right, God, we're going to do it. And the guy comes in and says, a little bird told me that one of you guys is good with computers. Unfortunately, I had to answer, and I said, I'm good with computers. And it was just like a light switch went off. I felt amazing. God had taken that sickness away, and it allowed me to do my gift, even though I thought it was something so routine and so mundane that I didn't want to do it. I know we all have gifts like this, and because of the gifts that God has given me, being able to use them in a different culture, I gave children internet that they may have never had if I wasn't there. Praise be to God for these little gifts that we're able to share in our society, because as we continue going on in our story, you're going to learn a lot of nations and a lot of peoples have different gifts. All of us in these churches, we have different gifts. We have different abilities, and we have different actions that we are called to be a part of. God didn't make us all the same, and I'm pretty sure that's on purpose. He didn't call for all of us to be exactly the same people and to worship in exactly the same way and understand concepts in exactly the same way, because we are different but united in that same spiritual ruach as we just talked about a couple minutes ago. But you see, Egypt was not so good for God's chosen people. And this is one of the three ways that unity is tried to be avoided by the world. I know that sentence didn't come out right. I'm sorry. Please bear with me. That's the way that the world tries to stop unity from happening. The first and probably the most blatant way, I'd say the worst way as well, is through the countries and through the states, through the empires. They decide, you guys can't worship anymore. You guys can't worship your Lord anymore. It's illegal. This has happened multiple times in our Bible. This has happened multiple times in our world here today. If we're sticking on our biblical crash course, I'm thinking about Daniel. Y'all know Daniel as Daniel in the lion's den. The reason he was thrown in the lion's den was because he kept worshiping his God, even when they made it illegal. I think about the story of Esther. I don't know why we don't talk about Esther very often, but we really should. Esther is a story about taking away punishment from the people because the Persian government was exploited to try to end the Jewish religion. But through God's grace and God's work, all of these times when all of the empires, all of the states, all of the countries have tried to stop God's will from happening, it's never worked. We just talked about it this morning with Saul, the apostle, or Saul to be Paul, the apostle. When the nations try to control God's people, it never works out well. We continue to meet together. It's not always in a nice building. Sometimes it's in a basement. Some cultures, it's actually in the middle of the woods. In some of the more remote areas of Russia and such, they will actually go and put markers in the woods, and they'll meet in the middle of the woods where nobody can find them. God's unifying power will continue to bring us together. Here's the second one. I promise we're still going forward in our biblical story. Is family. Sometimes we believe our family will go and make us go away from the gospel. Because for some reason we've got it laid in our hearts that our family is more important than the gospel. That the family that we've grown up with, our mom, our dad, our uncles, they're more important than Jesus. If I may remind you what our scripture says, it tells us that we are called to follow Jesus greater, to have more love for Jesus than our mothers, our fathers, our children, and our loved ones. There's a phrase that goes around. It's called blood is thicker than water. Have y'all ever heard that? Did you know that's not the full phrase? It's the blood of the covenant is thicker than the water of the womb. It's a reminder to all of us that our family, that's why Jesus is talking about you got to love your family more than you love, or you got to love me more than you love your family. Because your family will come to the Lord, and you can still be with that family, my friends. We are united under one single blood. We are united under the blood of the covenant, which is Jesus the Christ. It tells us that the friends that we choose are greater than the friends that we are born into. And that's what I'm saying about this unifying. That's why I decided to bring in all of these church people from other churches to come in, to remind us that it's not a denomination that makes us a Christian. It's not a church, one particular church that makes us a Christian and everybody else is wrong. We are united under the covenant of Jesus the Christ, where it tells us, we actually read this earlier, it's from Galatians. It says, there is no longer male or female. There is no longer rich or poor. There is no longer barbarian or Greek or Scythian. I don't know why they had barbarian and Scythian, because they were pretty much the same in that context. But there is only one in our Lord Jesus Christ. My brothers and sisters, that is the second one that stops us, is family. To get to historical context again, I think about King David. King David had a wonderful kingdom going on until his son messed it up. His son was upset about the way King David was running the kingdom, so he had a civil war. Cut the kingdom straight in half. So now we've got Judah on the south side, and we've got Israel on the top side. Families split it apart. But here's the thing. Even though families split it apart, God still remains with his people. Even though we took the promise that he gave us, crumpled it up, ripped it apart, spit it back in his face, God was still there for his people. So we sent prophets, and these prophets went and continued sharing God's word with all of the people, talking about who is going to come. A king is going to come. A king is going to come and fix everything right. Furthermore, the third one that stops us is our friends. The colleagues that we make, whether it's at work and we feel like we're too ashamed to share our gospel faith, whether we feel like we're too scared to do it, whether, honestly, whether there's policies at work that say you're not supposed to share your faith. I know there's several businesses and several companies that you can't work for. You can't even have pictures of your family up, let alone pictures of a cross, let alone pictures of Jesus up at your workstation. I also know people that get around that. I think about friends when I think about Jesus the Christ. That's right, we finally made it to the New Testament. Give you all a round of applause. We made it. We're halfway through the book. So Jesus had a very good, diverse set of friends, didn't he? These unified friends that came from all over the place. Not only do we have the elite, like the tax collectors, not only do we have the lowborn, like the fishermen, we got prostitutes, we got terrorists, we got all over the board. We got everybody you could ever ask for under the banner of Jesus the Christ. And one of them still betrayed him, didn't they? One of them still went against the grain and went against the King of Kings and the teacher. And you know, sometimes we sit here and we like to give Judas a bad rap, which I think is kind of justified for what had happened. But hear me out on this, because as y'all said earlier, sometimes you like my different approaches. You ever think that Judas was trying to jump the gun? Do you ever think Judas was trying to see the power of God right away? Do you ever think that he was trying to say, all right, well, maybe if I do something now, Jesus will be forced to show us that heavenly power he's been talking about. Maybe he'll be forced to make this heavenly army appear, and they'll kick everybody out, and we'll get that messianic king that we were promised. It worked. Maybe not the way that he thought, but sometimes we have friends like that that try to jump the gun, don't we? We got friends that get so caught up in something that they forget why they begin to do it in the first place. We get friends that get so caught up in a hobby, or get caught up in a relationship, or get caught up in family or in nations as we continue to escalate. They get caught up in things that aren't the gospel. My brothers and sisters in Christ, I have told you this before and I will tell you it again. We start with the gospel. We start with the words of Jesus the Christ. And I know that if we form everything else around that, everything will fall into place. Now I promise you, it's not going to be exactly how you thought it would be. I promise you, it's not going to be every single little meticulous detail is going to be exactly how you thought it was going to be. It will be different, but it will be different for the better. It will be different for the good of the Holy Spirit and for the good of God. My brothers and sisters, now I think about the end of our book. Hold on, I got one more. I'm sorry. I'm thinking about the book of Acts. We're actually going to do this scripture in 2 weeks, but I want to talk about it now because I really love this story. It's when Peter the Apostle, the one that walked on water, the one that said he wouldn't deny Jesus, but he went and did it 3 times anyways, the one that he was called by the Romans. One of the Roman governors had a vision and said, I need to talk to you. So he does. And he goes and gets Peter, which is, first of all, a really big no-no when you're going against the state. Because it would make Peter unclean to go and visit a Roman's house. It was in the laws. But he had this dream, right? This really weird dream where there's this blanket that comes out of nowhere. And all these animals are on top of the blanket, like pigs and snakes and cows and fish and all this stuff is like flopping around on a blanket. And he doesn't understand what it means. So he asks God, and he says this: do not call unclean what I have created. My brothers and sisters in Christ, that is the biggest part of all of this. Yeah, we can talk about the empires, about the great governments that tell us we can't worship God. We can talk about our families where we say, oh, we can't worship God. We can talk about our friends and say, well, our friends don't really agree with what we do. But the most important one of them all is ourselves. The most important one of them all is our own spirit. How often do we look at our neighbor, and not just your neighbor next door? How often do you look at somebody and say, well, they're just a panhandler. They don't deserve anything. They're just doing this to make money off of me. Or how often do we say, well, you know, they look upset, but I don't need to worry about them. They've probably got their own family. They've probably got their own things to take care of. Or we see somebody like, there's a gentleman at the McDonald's down the road. Every time around lunchtime, you can see him next to the trash can just looking for something to eat. How often do we say, well, you know, he'll find something. It's okay. I gotta get back to work. How often do we let ourselves get out of unity with God because it's convenient, because it's great, because it's fun, because it's easy to not be a disciple? Our world has made it so easy to not be a disciple, y'all. Our world has made it so easy just to show up at church, listen to a sermon, and go home. That's not what church is. Church is not these four walls with our beautiful green steeple. That is a church. That is not church. Church begins inside of us when we realize, God, I am sick and tired of going on these cycles. I am sick and tired of feeling like I'm not good enough. I am sick and tired of seeing all these mistakes that I'm making and not feeling like we're ever going to make this right. Because God will tell you the same thing he tells me. Trust in me. You are good enough. You are strong enough. There will be a chance, a new opportunity. You just have to follow me. Not the world. Not your family, not your friends. It begins with us, and then it goes outward into the rest of our community. My friends, my brothers and sisters in Christ, are you ready to answer the call that Jesus has laid on your heart? Are you ready to finally stop going to church and to be the church when you leave these doors? Are you ready to work with the rest of our denomination? Whether it's Baptist, whether it's Presbyterian, whether it's non-denominational, whether it's Episcopalian, whether it's whatever other denomination you can throw in a hat. Are you ready to stop acting like the church, and are you ready to be the church? Nobody?
Yeah,
amen. Amen, there you go. Amen, that's all I needed. Amen?
Amen.
Praise be to God in the highest, my friends. That was a little long. But you know, when the Spirit starts going, I don't put a timer on the Spirit. We didn't even make it to the end of the book. Hold on. I got one more little thing. So, to get back into Revelation, because I want to go through Genesis to Revelation. Revelation, the final thing happens. God has sent letters out to all of these churches and has told them all of their problems. And there's one thing in Revelation 4. I think it's 4:11, but don't quote me on that. No, it's later. But after all the letters have been read, and it's stuff like, oh, well, you know, this church, you guys are too exclusive. You're not letting in the poor. Or your church, you're so focused on money that you're not actually doing anything with it. Or you're not doing enough work in your community. We hear Jesus, and he says, listen, I am knocking on the door. If you let me in, we will have a feast abundant. We can talk. We can share food together. I am always knocking. Do you hear it? And I love that scripture because it reminds us of what happens in our own hearts. When we fall short, when we make mistakes, when we feel guilty and we're not good enough, guess what? He's still a knocking. He's not giving up. Our Lord is ever gracious, is ever forgiving, is ever ready to bring us back into this united circle that he has brought us into from the very beginning to the very end. As it says, in the end of the book, all of God's children will be united back with him in New Jerusalem when Eden has been recreated. We just went full circle from unity with God into the final promise that we will be unified with God in the end. Y'all ready to be unified here? Amen?
Amen.
Praise be to God in the highest. You got a few more songs in you?
Yeah, but I think people's getting turned.
No, you
know it's a little long.
I don't put timers on Spirit. How about this? You do one, and then we'll do when we all get to heaven.
Okay, that's good.
might be called Walk Around Heaven.
Walk Around Heaven? Walk.
Yes.
Walk Around Heaven.
Oh,
your opportunity to get back into action to bring forth unity. Y'all remember these?
Yeah.
There's more of them. Take some more with you. Share them. Give them to your friends. Take them to work. It does not matter to me, my friends. Amen?
Amen.
Peace be with you all.
See you all.
Thank you for worshiping with us tonight. We hope you'll join us.